So what we'll first do is that we'll review the last lecture and then we'll start the contents of this new lecture. So in the last lecture, if you remember, we started our discussion on piezoelectric ceramics. So basically, piezoelectric effect can be divided into two effects. One is direct effect and second is indirect effect. And direct effect is basically creation of polarization or change in polarization when you apply stress on the, and this gives rise to change in the charge density on the faces of the piezoelectric material. And the converse effect is essentially when you apply electric field, then you generate the strain at the in the piezoelectric or deformation on the faces of the piezoelectric. And these two effects are very useful effect, as we will see some of the applications. And then in order to make piezoelectric material useful, you need to pole it. And poling essentially means is that in the virgin state, a piezoelectric doesn't have any remnant polarization, which means it's not very useful as a piezoelectric. It must have some remnant polarization to be used as piezoelectric. So you pole it and then bring it back. So when you pole it, poling means application of electric field. So when you apply electric field, the domains, as you know from the ferroelectric discussion, domains start orienting themselves around along the direction of electric field. And when you make the electric field back to zero, then not all the domains change their orientation. As a result, the net polarization is not equal to zero. And then you, when you apply stress, then you get polarization at the faces of piezoelectric. And when you apply electric field, you get the deformation. And there are variety of material which show this effect. You have quartz, you have Rochelle salt, you have barium titanate, lead zirconate titanate, variety of materials, and the piezoelectric constant for these materials can be quite high. Some of these materials show piezoelectric constant as high as 200-300 picometer per volt, which is a very large displacement from the device point of view. And then finally, we looked at just like you have to pole a piezoelectric material to use it, you can also depole it. And depolarization of piezoelectric is essentially loss of polarization upon either thermal cycling or electric cycling or stress cycling. So we looked at all these three mechanisms in a cartoon and animation, and then so you can go through them again. Now what we'll do in this lecture is we'll look at some of the common piezoelectric materials. And among this category, the first candidate, which is simple piezoelectric, is barium titanate. And this barium titanate, as you know already, it has a perovskite structure, and so you have this barium titanate unit cell. And this material is ferroelectric below the Curie temperature, and Curie temperature happens to be roughly 120 degrees centigrade. And this material is a very useful material in the sense of uses. It's easy to make, and the ionic positions, if you remember, you have oxygen atom sitting at the faces, and then you have barium atom going at the corners of the unit cell, and then you have a smaller titanium atom going at the center of the unit cell. So this is barium, this is titanium, and this is oxygen. And this is a very useful material in the sense that it has a simple crystal structure. It can also be doped by variety of elements like cobalt. So doping with cobalt is cobalt 3 plus ions is very common, and this leads to reduced losses in the material. So cobalt reduces the losses, so this is a useful property which happens when you dope it. Now doping is although it sounds very easy, one must take enough care during processing so that you don't have reduction of cobalt 3 plus to cobalt 2 plus, which is also a possibility because COO is a stable state as well. And then you can also replace, so cobalt can replace titanium, and then you can also replace titanium atom by zirconium or tin, and these lead to increase in the TC, and so it also tends to enhance the piezoelectric properties. And you can also replace barium. Barium can be replaced by bigger ions such as lead or calcium, and they happen to lower the TC of barium titanate, especially from tetragonal to orthorhombic transition, which happens below 120 degrees centigrade. So basically all these dopants can be used to control the piezoelectric property of the material. And you know the polar vector of barium titanate is along 001 axis in the ferroelectric state, where it has a tetragonal structure. So I'm not going to spend too much time on this structure because we have already discussed this structure in the ferroelectric materials. But so just as a material of interest, I'm going to tell you about this little bit. So this, and the next material of interest is, which is actually more important than this material, is lead zirconium titanium oxide, or often called as PZT. And this is a very important material. It's solid solution of lead titanate and lead zirconate. So basically what it has a perovskite structure of the type lead titanate, where the B site is randomly occupied by either of titanium and zirconium ions. And so you have again the similar sort of structure. So you have lead ions sitting here, and oxygen ions go to the let me use a different color. So oxygen ions go to the face centers, and the central atom is titanium. So of course titanium is shifted towards this axis if the structure was tetragonal, and if the structure was rhombohedral, then it would be shifted along 111. So it has two structures essentially. The parent structure of lead titanate is tetragonal in the ferroelectric phase, and this is rhombohedral. So depending upon the composition, depending upon the proportion of lead titanate and lead zirconate with respect to each other, the material PZT either adopts a tetragonal structure or rhombohedral structure. A tetragonal structure has a polar vector along 001, and rhombohedral structure has along 111. So this is the difference which occurs when you go from tetragonal to rhombohedral side. And the phase diagram of this material is, so just before we go to phase diagram, let me complete this. So you have here lead atom, then these are oxygen atoms, and this atom is titanium or zirconium, Ti or Zr. So this B site is randomly occupied by either of titanium and zirconium ions. So let me show you the phase diagram of this material. So you have it makes a continuous solid solution. So what you have is a on one end, so it's a pseudo binary diagram, phase diagram. So you have PbZr(O3), and then you have PbTiO3, and if you plot with respect to mole percent PT, which is lead titanate, so you get something like this point corresponds to, so what you have here is you have a cubic phase here. Now this is of course temperature, and this is somewhere between, so this is about 500 degrees centigrade, and this is somewhere around 600 degrees centigrade. And here you have lead titanate, whose TC is significant, Kelvin, not centigrade. So you have Kelvin, and this is approximately 850 Kelvin or so, or maybe 800 Kelvin or so. So you have cubic at the top, which is above this phase boundary, which is on the top. And then between these phase boundaries, you have here, in this region, what you have is called as a rotational phase. In this phase boundary, you have ferroelectric rhombohedral phase. And what you have here is, so this is high temperature rhombohedral phase. And then this is low temperature rhombohedral phase. Now, there is some demarcation which has been shown by scientists between these two phases, details of which we are not going to go into. It's beyond the scope of this thing, but what you have is some distinction between these two phases. So, low temperature ferroelectric phase here, and then again this is rhombohedral in nature. And then you have tetragonal phase here. Ferroelectric tetragonal phase here. So you can see that beyond this, so across this boundary, which is this phase boundary, on one side, on the lead titanate rich side, you have tetragonal ferroelectric phase below the top phase boundary, below the transition, because this top phase boundary depicts a transition, okay, from ferroelectric to paraelectric phase. So cubic, this is paraelectric phase, and on the left of this phase boundary, vertical phase boundary, you have a rhombohedral ferroelectric phase, which is again below the cubic region. Now, this boundary which separates these two regions is called as a morphotropic phase boundary. Or it's called as MPB. Okay, so this MPBB is of immense importance, because what happens is that across MPB you have existence of either rhombohedral structure or tetragonal structure, but the moment we come to MPB, whose composition is happens to be around 53 47, or roughly about 50 50, let's say. So around this morphotropic phase boundary, what you have is coexistence of both these phases. So at this MPB you have coexistence of tetragonal and rhombohedral phases. So if you take morphotropic phase boundary composition, you are likely to have both of these phases present if you have made the sample properly, and this morphotropic phase boundary as a result results in a large enhancement in the property. Why it happens is because, since you have both the phases present, you have tetragonal phase present, you have rhombohedral present, and both of these phases have polar vector in different directions. As a result, when you use the material, when you apply electric field or stress to it, you have many polar directions which are available for piezoelectric activity. So as a result, the pooling of this material becomes very easy. So this material near MPB composition, which is 50-50 composition, has a very significant importance for a variety of applications, simply because the properties are enhanced significantly near this composition. And remember, this is called as a morphotropic phase boundary. Let me just circle it for you. Or often called as MPB. And this MPB composition in PZT is an extremely important composition from the technological point of view, because of enhancement of properties. So you can write here, so properties which are ferroelectric as well as piezoelectric are enhanced near MPB in PZT, and this is also true about other systems as well, not only PZT. Other examples are, for instance, BIFEO3, PbTiO3. So again, BiFeO3 is also ferroelectric, PbTiO3 is also ferroelectric, and both of these make a continuous solid solution, and again they also exhibit a MPB at 70-30 composition, 70% bismuth ferrite and 30% lead titanate mole percent, and at this composition, again in this system, one, the transition temperature is high because lead titanate bismuth ferrite transition temperature is much higher than lead titanate transition temperature. So overall solid solution has reasonably high transition temperature. Two, the piezoelectric coefficient attains piezoelectric coefficient as well as polarization attain a large enhancement near the MPB, in at least in the bulk form and thin film form. And so this is PZT is a very important material from this point of view, that especially near the morphotropic phase boundary composition. Now you can change the properties of PZT by doping, again just like in case of barium titanate. If you dope it with other elements, the properties change. Now typically what happens is that most of these oxides tend to be deficient in oxygen, and from the defect chemistry you know. So now oxygen vacancy is now, these are charge defects, right? The moment you have charge defects, you have problem with the conduction. So as a result, the conductivity of sample is higher and the sample tends to be lossy and conducting. Now how to get rid of this problem? So if you have oxygen vacancies which are noted by VOO dot dot, so which means they contain two positive charges. So if you dope the material by, let's say, a material like element like lanthanum, so if you dope the material like La2O3, so lanthanum goes to on lead site or titanium site, it goes to lead site and PZLT, yes, and then what you have is basically lanthanum carries one extra charge, so as a result it carries one positive charge. Now 2 lanthanum will go to 2 lead sites, 3 oxygens will go to 3 oxygen sites. So you need to create what can happen is you need to create either, now side balance is not maintained because for each lead you have one oxygen. Now here you're using 3 oxygen for 2 leads, so side balance is not maintained. In order to do that, if you have an oxygen vacancy here, VOO, this VOO is compensated by this extra oxygen. So not only, so 2 oxygens go to the regular oxygen sites and another oxygen goes to the vacant oxygen site. Thereby, so if you look at the charge balance, 2 positive on the oxygen vacancy, 2 positive on the 2 lanthanum sites and lanthanum occupying lead sites, and this maintains the charge and side balance, but also it reduces the reduction in the oxygen vacancy, and this leads to improve properties of the material. And so basically reduction in defect density upon lanthanum doping. And these defects also have, not only they increase the conductivity, but they also tend to impede the domain motion, because you know that the domain in the ferroelectric materials, they nucleate and then they grow. So this growth of these domains, or when you switch the material, the switching of domains is impeded by these defects. These defects typically pin these boundaries, and these boundaries are not able to move the way you would like them to move. So as a result, the properties degrade. So this particular aspect can be tackled by doping with appropriate elements, which lead to reduction in the defect density. And this has also other advantages. It reduces the dielectric losses. It increases. It also improves the coupling coefficient, and it also leads to reduction in the coercivity as a result of easy domain motion. So what we are going to now do is, so we have discussed these two materials which are important materials. There are a variety of other materials as well which are reported in the literature. So if you go to the journals and some books, you can find a discussion on other materials as well. So now what we will do is that we will look at the how these properties are measured. Now, measurement of piezoelectric property of piezoelectric material is important, and these techniques are typically called as resonance. And basically, these measurements are used to measure the displacement when you apply electric field. So basically, they rely on measurement of displacement upon electric field. So now what happens is, in the resonance of, first we will discuss the resonance technique. So in the resonance technique, the you measure that characteristic resonance frequency of the material, which depends upon the frequency application of the alternating field, and this is ideally used for bulk samples. So essentially, it's about measurement of resonance frequencies, and typically it's used for bulk samples. And now we can also model this response of the material by electrical circuit. So you have, so basically you have this electrical circuit. So you have this capacitance in series with a resistance, and then you have an inductance which is in parallel with the capacitance again. So this part of the circuit, so basically this is CM, R, L, and this is C, D. So the variety, and this equivalent circuit gives you the sort of models the behavior of the material well enough. And this part, top part of the circuit, represents the mechanical contribution, and this part represents the electrical contribution. And so this electro, so basically what the response of the material is electromechanical. So as a result, so you have coupling of electrical and mechanical parameters. So as a result, you need to separate out the electrical part and the mechanical part, and this is what the circuit does. It separates the electrical and mechanical parts, and and this happens, and this is applicable when the frequencies are close to a characteristic or resonance frequencies. And so what you basically do is that, so when you plot as a function of frequency, because you are applying AC field is frequency dependent, so at some frequency you are going to have resonance which is going to occur. So what you have, if you measure the reactance, now this reactance goes as, so this is your resonance, and basically you are interested in calculating the frequency around which this resonance occurs. And typically for these measurements you take a material of cylindrical shape. So essentially a rod, and this rod could be about 6 inch in length, and in diameter it's about 1/4 inch or so. So these kind of samples are taken for these measurements. And this is, and when you plot electrical reactance as a frequency, then you come across the characteristic frequency, which is basically the frequency that you want to measure. And there are two frequencies here, one is the series frequency, second is the parallel frequency, and you need to be able to, you can utilize these frequencies to determine what is called as a coupling coefficient. So this coupling coefficient which is K33 this can be expressed in terms of series and parallel resonance frequencies. So this K33 can be so this K33 square basically is equal to pi by 2 into Fs by Fp multiplied by tan of pi by 2 into Fs, sorry, Fp minus Fs divided by Fp. So this Fs is series resonance frequency and Fp is parallel resonance frequency. And if you use this relation along with the elastic compliance, so elastic compliance, as we know, is denoted as SE33 at constant field, and then low frequency dielectric constant is epsilon 33, and then piezoelectric coefficient is D33. Then if you couple the K33 coupling coefficient as we measured in the previous slide, as we wrote in the previous slide, if you couple with these two parameters, you can determine D33. So D33 is equal to K33 multiplied by SE33 into epsilon 33 x to the power half. So this is the expression for determination of D33. So just by applying electric field to a rod sample, you measure the reactance of this sample by modeling in terms of electrical circuit, find out the series and parallel frequencies, and then put these frequencies in the expression of K33 to find out K33. And if you know the elastic compliance of the material and low frequency dielectric constant, which can be found out from the dielectric measurements, you can determine what is the piezoelectric coupling coefficient. Now, these the limitation with this process is that the fundamental resonance frequencies are determined by the resonance frequencies of the sample are determined by the fundamental vibration modes. Now, this is typically in case of piezoelectric samples, it happens in the gigahertz frequency range. And these gigahertz frequencies are very high frequencies, making measurements in, so in these range, these frequency ranges is not easy. So what you have limitations is frequencies at resonance fall in gigahertz range, so measurements are difficult, because you need to adopt variety of tricks in order to variety of precautions to make the measurements at gigahertz frequencies. And so in such cases, what you do is that basically you measure the do the measurement in the sub resonance frequency. So sub resonance methods, and basically in the sub resonance method, what happens is that typically for thin films this is important. So when you have thin film is always deposited on a substrate. So the substrate can be used as a sub so the peak of so you can determine the you can use the substrate as a means to determine the piezoelectric coupling of the film. And so again, the problem here is characteristic frequencies are also determined by electromechanical response of the material, and if the electrochemical frequency mechanical frequencies are not characteristic frequencies are smaller in number, then of course the measurement becomes difficult. Sub resonance so in case of thin film, you can just, if you go to previous slide, In case of, let's say, thin films, use resonance of substrates. So in the case of sub resonance, basically measurements at frequencies below resonance frequencies. So basically these frequencies are at much lower frequencies, which is attainable and without any difficulty, and so at resonance frequency, which are nothing but characteristic norm fundamental vibration modes, and basically this basically is nothing but measurement of direct effect. And you know what direct effect is? Basically the you measure the charge which is developed on the faces of piezoelectric under the application of stress, and direct effect as well as indirect effect, which is the measurement of displacement or strain as a result of applied electric field. So although here the displacements can be very small, but nowadays we have techniques which can measure these displacements, such as AFM, etc. So AFM, you can have strain gauges, high quality strain gauges, LVDTs, which is linear variable differential transformers. So all these so basically technological advances have enabled us to measure these small displacements. So small displacements, but they can be measured by techniques like AFM, LVDT, high precision gauges, etc. So basically you in summary, there are two techniques. One is a resonance technique, second is sub-resonance technique. Resonance technique essentially relies upon the measurement of the characteristic frequencies of vibration. But the problem with here is that these frequencies can be quite high, which means in the gigahertz or higher range, and these frequencies make the life of a characterization person difficult. So as a result, these are not often successful. What you have is sub-resonance method, where you measure either the polarization or the displacement. The trouble with these methods is that the amount of charge which is developed or amount of strain which is developed can be very small, but nowadays we have techniques which can measure all these small changes. So as a result, sub-resonance methods have become much more common. What we will do now is we will just have a look at some of the applications of piezoelectric materials before we move on to the next material, next system. Now, as you know, piezoelectric materials, since they have direct effect and converse effect, and which means they either give rise to changes in the polarization or changes in the dimension of the sample or strain, you can use them in a variety of applications. So for instance, some of the early applications or some of the very trivial applications in the beginning, for instance, you must have seen a gas lighter. Now, gas lighter, when you press the button, it gives rise to a spark and through which you light your gas. And this can be used, this is called as a power generation method. So basically, in case of power generation, for instance, as a gas lighter, you can use a piezoelectric material. And what basically you do is that, in this case, you require two piezoelectric pieces with two with different opposite polarization states. So what you have is here is you have a piezoelectric material like this, and then another piezoelectric material close to it, okay, and these two faces have similar charges, okay. So you have positively oriented faces here, So this positive, so you have two faces which are of opposite polarity, same polarity next to each other. Of course, you need to put a sort of, you need to put electrodes on the faces. And essentially you connect these together. So, and this is basically the spark gap, because when you bring these together, then since they are of similar charges, there is a sparking, and that sparking gives rise to this spark, which is used to light the flammable substances. So application of basically stress or stress will induce a change in the polarization. So when you apply stress, so when you press the button, basically you are applying the stress. So when you press the stress, this induces a change in the polarization of the faces, and this gives rise to a spark, creation of charges, and this creation of charges leads to creation of a spark, and then you have charge flow through the electrical circuit, giving rise to light. And the problem is the whole phenomena happens fairly quickly. So in order to use this as a method of power generation, let's say here very small power is generated, so in order to use this device as a gas lighter, it has to happen extremely quickly. So because the voltage which would be generated between the faces will quickly disappear, so one needs to use this as very quick or sort of instantaneous method. Because you must have seen that the moment you press the lighter, the spark comes instantaneously, but it doesn't stay for long. So one must use this immediately. The second application, which is of importance using piezoelectric material in power generation, is power transformers. Now, in contrast to regular transformers, which basically use the electromagnetic coupling between the input and the output, here what you have is utilize. So, these here what you have piezoelectric materials, which utilize the acoustic coupling, which are based on acoustic coupling effect, due to converse piezoelectric effect. And what it means is that when you apply electric field, the piezoelectric generates strain, and these strains can be large enough to give rise to acoustic waves, and so you have and then you can couple these waves in order to create high voltages. And these can be used as compact devices. They don't necessarily need to be of large size. And essentially this alternating stress, which is created by alternating field, can be quite large in nature. And essentially the frequency ranges that we are interested here is vibration frequency is of the order of 100 kilohertz to 1 megahertz, and the step up ratios of typically 1000 to 1 can be achieved. A simple diagram for this is shown in the next slide. I'll show you in the next slide. So what you have here is essentially a piezoelectric material. So the way the circuit is drawn here is, so you apply low voltage here. This is the low voltage side, and coupling between the piezoelectrics give rise to high voltage on this side. So essentially it's about applying electric field, alternating electric field, which gives rise to large stresses because of in converse effect, and this gives rise to acoustic waves. These acoustic waves couple with each other in order to give rise high voltages in the transformer made of piezoelectric material. So in comparison to normal devices, this can be very small in size. And the next application that one could think is a piezoelectric sensor. So in these, typically you use mechanical force or pressure. So use of mechanical pressure to give an electrical signal. So basically, for instance, this is used in microphone. In case of microphone, the sound waves can deform the piezoelectric element, and this gives rise to a changing voltage. So essentially, sound waves give rise to a deformation, and this gives rise to voltage change. And so, and this is a principle which is also used in, for instance, in variety of guitars and other microphones. And so this is one application where you sense the input to give an output. Okay, so typically it's based on use of mechanical pressure, which is the input, to give an electrical output from a piezoelectric material. So this is what it is. So essentially, you have a piezoelectric material, you give an input, and this input is typically mechanical, and what you get in output. Other applications, other sensor applications are so. For instance, you can have detection and generation of sonar waves. This is something which was used in World War as well. And you can also determine, for instance, the precise movement of. You can use piezoelectric to control the fuel supply in an automotive engine. So, to control the fuel supply in an automotive engine, it can also be used for detection of acoustic emissions. And it can also be used as a strain gauge. So in most of these applications, the input remains a mechanical signal and output is electrical signal. You can have many other applications. You can have medical applications. In case of medical applications, first could be kidney stone treatment. So essentially, what happens is that when you apply a high frequency field to the sample, and this gives rise to change in the shape of the material. This gives rise to basically emission of waves which are whose frequency in the ultrasound range. These are called the ultrasound waves, and these ultrasound waves are then passed through the body. They hit the kidney stone and shatter it, and then which can pass through the urine. So this is, I'll show you the animation of this. And the second could be ultrasound imaging. And this is typically used in the case of a pregnant woman to determine the sex of the child before the birth in the fetus. So I'll show you the animation of this as well. And so we'll just go to the animation. This is the gas lighter. So just to go back. So, if you remember, first application that we talked was the gas lighter. So, piezoelectric can be used to generate a spark which ignites gases by generating a current. And again, just to acknowledge, this was taken from doitbombs.ac.uk. So, basically, for this, we take two piezoelectric material and in such a manner so that their polarization is reversed. So, you have these two materials. And the polarization of these two materials is in opposite direction, and when you apply the stress, the polarization changes as a result of application of stress, which means the increase in the polarization here. So you bring the faces with the similar charges together in order to create a spark. So these are the two similar faces, and then they are connected to a circuit, and when you bring them together, they generate a charge when you apply stress, and this charge travels to the circuit, giving rise to a spark in the gap, and this leads to creation of a flame. So this is something which has to happen very quickly, as I said before. And the other application was based on, let me just find out. So the first one, so as I said, piezoelectrics have found applications in medical area. Again, this animation is taken from doitbombs.ac.uk, so we acknowledge their help with this. So the first one is non-invasive treatment, which is the kidney treatment. So basically, when you apply a field of high frequency to a piezoelectric, the resultant, you have a resultant change in the shape, and that gives rise to creation of ultrasound waves. So this is how you are doing. You are applying stress to the you are applying a field of changing frequency. As a result, the material is compressing or expanding, and this compression expansion of materials alternating gives rise to ultrasound waves. And these ultrasound waves, when they are pointed towards a kidney stone, for instance, in a body, they can basically break it. And this is a very good technique for breaking of kidney stones. And this can pass through the body fluids later on when it becomes of smaller size. Other technique is used in the imaging, and here basically it's based on, again you generate the ultrasound waves by application of electric field, and these ultrasound waves in this case, they can reflect from the tissue boundaries, and they can be, and these reflected waves can be observed to produce the image of the internal body, for instance a fetus. And basically, again, as I said, that these ultrasound waves are produced by applying field of high frequency or reversing the electric field over it. So the principle is same. So these waves, they pass through the body until they hit a boundary, and some of them will reflect. So essentially, this is the body, and the waves have traveled in this direction, and some of them have reflected back. And they again are collected through the same piezoelectric, and when these waves will hit a piezoelectric, they will again create change in the polarization or give rise to charge, and this can be used to monitor the magnitude of this charge, can be used to monitor the image. So ultrasound waves cause the reverse effect, the converse effect. And by altering the shape of the piezoelectric, this causes a charge to be produced on the end of the piezoelectric, which can be detected. And as a result, you get and this is interpreted by the computer, giving rise to a image. So this is what I wanted to show you, these slides, just to show you the applications. So finally, and these are also used in some applications like actuators. Nowadays, the engineering or technological advances happen at very precise scale. So earlier, the precision could be of millimeter level, but now the precisions have gone into the range of micron and submicron range. So as a result, to achieve this technological perfection, the devices need translation which is as precise. So basically, the linear motion or the rotational motion have to be of very high precision. So in this case, piezoelectrics can be used quite well, because piezoelectrics, as you know, when you apply electric field, they have a displacement which is of the order of microns or even submicrons or picometers, it's a picometer to microns, and this helps us in controlling the translation or rotation in a device to very high accuracy. So essentially, here application of high electric field and this high electric field without now you have to use it without the oscillations. So this high electric field gives rise to extremely small changes in the crystal dimension. So of course you have to use a material whose piezoelectric constant is likewise appropriate, and the precision here could be can be better than 1 micron. So that tells you the level of accuracy that we are achieving here, and that is why these piezoelectrics can be used as a very useful precise actuators, motors, etc. And so you can use voltages of the order of 150-200 volt, and in these can be used, for instance, in the material in the thin film form, which can give you displacements of the order of microns, as you said. So again, let me just give you some of the applications of sensing application, this actuator applications. So actuator applications can be used, for instance, in AFM. In AFM, atomic force microscope, you move the tip of the sample by taking the tip up and down, and this movement has to be very precise, and this precise movement is achieved by the use of a piezoelectric material. You can have piezoelectric motors, and these motors basically you have up and down movement through rotation, and this happens extremely precisely since and this you can control by changing the electric field that you apply. We can do mirror alignment, especially in the laser area where the mirror alignment have to be very precise. Loudspeakers, and inkjet printer, another very important use of piezoelectric material. Here, by changing the electric field, you can control the precision of piezoelectric diaphragm to regulate the supply of ink on the paper, and of course the fuel injectors in the engines, etc. So all of these are very important applications. And finally, last application that I'm going to talk about is frequency standard. So frequency standards, basically piezoelectric materials can be used as a standard of frequency, and this is what happens in quartz watches. The watches that we wear, they contain piezoelectric, and they use so basically you have a quartz tuning fork which uses a combination of direct and converse effect, and to give you a regulated pulses, electrical pulses which are used to correctly mark the time. And they have, since these materials have fundamental frequency of vibration at very specific frequencies, they can be used to stabilize the frequency. When you apply a periodic voltage, then you can stabilize the frequency of vibration, and these frequencies are very precise frequencies, so you can determine, you can use these frequency as a standard. And this is also used, same principles is also used in radio transmitters as well as receivers. So whose details I'm not going to go into, but if you want to go into details of applications of piezoelectrics, I would suggest that you go through the books on electroceramics by Molson and Herbert. These titles are also provided in the bibliography of the course as a separate link. So you can go through them. So we'll finish the lecture today here, which is essentially end of piezoelectric materials. In the next lecture, we will take up the case of pyroelectric materials, and then we finish this discussion on nonlinear dielectrics. Thank you.